Thanks to all of you for coming. It really is good, and I was a little surprised that it was that many folks that we haven't seen since 2019. And I don't know about you, but as you go around last night in the networking event and the happy hour, I just kept trying to remember, did I meet this person just from here up, or have I actually met them in person? And when was the last conference you've been to where it starts with the cleaning gel? Is that what you, the hand gel and masks are over here as opposed to the exits are over there, and if there's an emergency, follow David as he runs out. So normally we start it that way, but this is different. And so it's different times. And it really is good to have everybody back and together. And I'm going to start where I'll end by saying I really hope we all take advantage of this time together. I hope we take advantage of the time to network in a less than, in a safe way, in a way that that we can talk about the challenges we're facing. And what I want to do this morning is just talk a little bit about that. I'm not going to rehash the whole pandemic, but I'm going to talk a little bit about what the pandemic has led to and some of the challenges and the hard things that we've all faced. Just to start, these last few years, let's admit, have been astonishing. Okay, so we've had all kinds of risks that are accelerating in the environment, and it's not just the environment, it's about everything that we're dealing with. Of course, we had the COVID-19 pandemic, and not to necessarily rehash that, but to talk through anyway the result and the outcomes. And I think last night I was talking with Scott or with Rich, and we all have our own COVID story. There's a story there that we've all taken into our lives in lots of different ways, and I'll talk a little bit about that as we go through this. But what started with this pandemic has come out with a whole, we've got all kinds of other waves coming at us repeatedly. We've got the impacts of climate change. And so you'll hear from some of the speakers later today and tomorrow, you know, it's like one wave after another. You have the pandemic, but then the last few years it's been sustainability, 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 and then boom. My prices have gone through the roof, and what I'm paying for this stuff is crazy. I've got volatility crushing down on me. So we have all of these things coming at us and these challenges, and those challenges aren't just affecting us in business. It's affecting our teams. It's affecting the way we interact with each other. It's affecting our families and communities. And I was thinking, you know, I've met many of our own team members, families and kids as they go by in the background, and you see parents juggling work and having kids in the background, and sometimes you take them, I'll take them. Many of you have met my dogs as the daily Amazon truck pulls up, and it's like it's the first time. You know, and after a couple months of that, you go, look, it's not new. You know, you're gonna see that thing again tomorrow driving up. And so we meet our dogs, we meet our kids. We got different ways of working. We've got all these challenges in front of us hitting us in different ways, and then we layer in a war. And we have a conflict going on. And we don't know who's doing what to whom at a certain point. And it gets really confusing and challenging, and it affects us in lots of different ways. And we've all witnessed this frustration, both in our personal lives, in our communities, and in our work. And it used to feel like these things were in their own silos, like they were separate. And what I've come to believe is they're just not. They're integrated. So when we stand there, you know, with different members of you last night, and we're talking about how's life going, oftentimes it goes to the challenges that span outside the business and into our personal lives and how we're dealing with some of this stuff. And so if I dial back to the pandemic, I think we've all got those stories. I know members of our team, there's members of our team that didn't get to attend a parent's funeral because of COVID. There's members of our team that didn't get to attend the birth of a child because of restrictions that were placed on who could go in into the hospital. So we've got all kinds of different things today. And the key for us is, what are we going to do? How are we going to do this going forward? What changes are going to be made? What's permanent? And I think one of the things that we've had to learn is we need to build in capacity in ourselves, in our businesses, in our teams, the capacity to step back and rejuvenate and figure out, where are we going from here? What are we going to do? How do we adapt? What's the environment? That may mean new products and services and technologies. It may mean new members of our teams. It may mean new approaches to how we manage our life at home and how we work with our families and integrate all of those things. But my hope this week is that we use this time to also build capacity in ourselves, capacity to learn, capacity to create new relationships, capacity to try new things. And we'll jump into a little bit of that as to how we're going to meet these challenges and what we're going to do. And I love the story of John F. Kennedy and the space race. Now, if you go back at this time, some of you were not born at this time. I was barely born at this time. But he said, we choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. It was a great quote at the time that we're in we in America, in the U.S., are in a race with Russia to get to the moon. Okay, so some of you may remember that, or at least you've read about it or studied it in school. So we're in this race, and he says, we've got to get the country around this thing. Not because it's easy, but because it's hard. And so he lays out that challenge, and he makes this promise. And he takes a big risk in making this promise and stepping out there and saying, we're going to do this. And he didn't know how he was going to do it. Now, we've all made promises like this in our lives, where we make the promise, and we're not sure how we're going to do it. In some cases, it feels like my annual business review, where I'm being given a certain target that I think is impossible. How are we going to meet that, and how are we going to do it? And I felt that way a year ago, and I wasn't sure how we were going to do it and how we were going to accomplish that. And then I have to dial up to now and say, well, I felt that way then. I feel the same way now, but you know what? We can do this, and we can make promises and take risks and figure out how we're going to do this and meet the needs of our clients in ways that we didn't think of before. So he makes this promise, and what's cool about this is he wasn't sure how. Well, that promise he made translates down to promises that people on his team and others had to make as well. And so when I think about this, the risk he took to step out there and say that, it's pretty substantial. And I don't know if any of you have seen the movie Hidden Figures, one of my favorite movies, one of my favorite movies and favorite scenes for lots of reasons. But you had the three main characters. Katherine Johnson was kind of the star, so to speak. She was the one doing all the figures and the calculations. And I don't know if you remember the scene where John Glenn, who's now the recipient of John F. Kennedy's promise, and he's going to make a big promise and take a big risk because he's going to step into that capsule and he's going to go to the moon, right? And he looks at Katherine Johnson, at least in the movie, and he says, I'm not going until she runs the numbers. So they were crossing all kinds of boundaries, bad boundaries, that had been established at that time. Katherine Johnson, and when you see in the movie, she's crossing boundaries that never should have been there to begin with, obviously. But she's crossing these boundaries. He's also crossing boundaries. He's like, I don't give a rip about the boundary. I care because she's smart and she gets the numbers right. Well, what this took with John F. Kennedy was a collaboration between government, science, private sector, and people to step in and take on this challenge and the promise that he made that this is where we're going. Many of you, your companies have made promises. You've gone through SBTI, you've gone through all these other initiatives, and you've made certain promises, and you don't know how to get there. The good news is others like you have gone before and done similar things. And I love that scene when John Glenn says that to Katherine Johnson. And she turns around and she goes out and she runs the numbers. Now in the movie, she ran the numbers in about 25 seconds. In real life, as I read back, I think it was 2 or 3 days, because he wasn't sitting up in the capsule waiting, you know, to hit the button. But nonetheless, he looked at her, he counted on her as an expert to step in and run those numbers, and he relied on it when he took that promise. Well, it's not too dissimilar. Okay, we're not going to the moon here, but we are talking about the health of our planet. We're talking about the health of our families. We're talking about the health of our companies and our businesses. And I don't just mean from a green environmental perspective. I mean economically as well. I mean socially as well. There are all of these things coming into play here where we're going to have to make some promises and we're going to have to take some risks. So one of the eye-openers for me, I got to share, this past summer, it's real easy for me to just think about this as figures or numbers or science-based targets or goals, etc. And this past summer, for the first time of all the times I've gone to France and Europe for business, I really have never vacationed. Now, I wasn't on vacation here, but I took an afternoon at the foot of Mont Blanc with a group of folks from work, and I got this shot. I don't know, for those of you who are 2019, I don't know if you remember the picture of me on the edge of Victoria Falls with my family. That was the year we were taking risk and saying yes. Well, this one I thought, okay, I got to get a picture of this with my kids. So it's a steep drop-off down below, and so I wedged my feet in there because one of my goals is to always impress my kids with pictures that I come back with so that there's some element of coolness to me, even though it, and the wind was blowing, okay? The wind was blowing, and I felt a little dizzy standing there. But I'm standing over Mer de Glace, which is the largest glacier in France and the third largest, I think, in the Alps. And that's what you see down below. And honestly, this picture isn't about me. That's why my back's to the camera. It was a phenomenal, stunning view. Now, I love the outdoors. I love just this hike that we were on was amazing. And they had two glaciologists along with us. And I'm standing up there amazed at it. By the way, when you see the glacier down there, there are climbers in the crevices practicing their climbing. So that's really far down. I think one of the boulders the guy pointed out was bigger than a house. And I was like, really? We're way up here. And he said, yeah, watch where you're standing. And so I'm looking down at this, and then he showed us these pictures from the same spot. That's where this was in the year 1900, and then again in the year 2000, and then you layer again in 2022. So we can sit here and we can say, you know what? We can argue about how it got that way, and we can argue about how it's going to change, but you can't argue about it, okay? Because the eyes don't lie. You look at these pictures, 1900, 2000, I stood there, and when he showed me those pictures, I went, holy mackerel, this really is real. Now, I know that might sound odd. I'm running the sustainability business for Schneider Electric, okay, but I also think there are times in your personal lives where you come face-to-face with what you're looking at and go, whoa, this is real. This is incredibly beautiful environment, and what a difference this has made in this time. Now, there's all kinds of events and different things happening around the world. We have weather events that sometimes you point to. You know, obviously Hurricane Ian that hit South Florida. And then you do the math and you say, well, there were 16 major storms prior to 1965 and only six since or something like that. You can do all that you want and argue about whether specific weather events are climate related or not. But quite frankly, I stood there and looked at this glacier and I said, this is nuts. What's going on here? How do we do this? And I'm sitting here taking this picture before the glaciologist pulls out the other photos and says, now look. Now look at this and see the change. So we're facing these challenges, whether we want to admit to it or not. And I'll admit that I'm facing them, whether at times I want to admit to them or not. Am I still on? All right, didn't mean to hit that. My kids were impressed with the picture, but then I also showed them the other pictures so that they could see the before and after, so it wasn't all about me, you know, standing up on the edge and not falling over like an idiot. But we are facing these challenges on many fronts. And I'm just going to talk about a few of them and how they affect. I mentioned already hitting our businesses, our teams, our economy, and our planet. And these are all becoming intermingled. They're all intersecting in different ways as we try to climb this mountain together and figure out what we're going to do. The answer for us, really, on all of this, it's a very broad answer, but as we've reflected on it, it's about resilience for all of us. And it's about how do we build resilience into our personal lives and our families? How do we build resilience into our communities? How do we build resilience into our impact on the climate? On how do we run our businesses in a sustainable economic way? And so we've got to think through, what do we need to do to become a more resilient individual, company, all of those different things as we think about how we proceed on this journey. This pandemic has shown us, I think, many things that were underneath all the time. And what the pandemic showed us is that our human systems are just not as safe as they have been in the past. We are very vulnerable. So when we see a congruence or a confluence of events like a pandemic, like a war in Europe or in Ukraine, conflicts in other parts of the world sometimes that don't get the news in the same way. We see the economic impact, the inflation going on. We see constrained supply chains. We see the great resignation where people are looking over the fence going, the grass is greener on the other side. Let me go try it over there. And you know what? I don't fault folks for looking at how do I do this different? How do I want to improve my life? Now, I'm glad that even in the pandemic, we had some folks leave and some of those same folks come back. So there's all kinds of things that people are dealing with about how do we become more resilient. But our human systems are clearly vulnerable. And we're going to have to transform those systems in a way that makes sense for our company and ourselves as well. And that's going to require a significant amount of collaboration in order to get there. And again, the commercial for this week is take advantage of the fact that we are all occupying this planet and this ecosystem together. So take advantage of the fact that we're all together like this for a couple days. create the human capital in yourself and the space necessary to really come to grips with some of these things and take some cool things away from the week and the interaction. I want to camp on just a few of these main challenges for a moment, for a few minutes, in terms of how do we do it, what are they, and there's four that I'm going to talk about. There's a lot more, but these four I want to mention. One, first one is the risk management. I mentioned earlier, sustainability has been the theme, and then all of a sudden, holy crap, what are we going to do about these prices? And we're hearing that everywhere. We're hearing it in our own company. And it calls for really good, strong risk management plans and approaches and anticipation and thinking about it in a whole new way, in a whole new way that we haven't thought before. We have some clients that just stopped when it got stopped hedging, thinking, oh my goodness, let's just hold off and not do this. At the end of 2021, said prices have already crept up, so they were hedged great through 2022, but didn't take much for 2023, or they stopped policies, or they changed what they were doing, because I thought, surely it can't get any worse than this. And guess what? It did. It got worse. And so there are people on all sides of the equation. So we can talk about the overall value that's been created in this room and the value you've delivered to your companies in terms of mark-to-market value or that kind of thing in terms of the hedging activity, but you still have to deal with the unhedged and the exposure that's out there in a highly volatile market. And for us not to acknowledge that would be crazy. And I think there's going to be sessions where we talk about that and what we think about is going to happen going forward. And Robbie, I don't know if I just put a lot of pressure on you, but somewhere in there, Robbie will be waving the magic wand, the Swami or something. But we need to acknowledge the challenge that's there and how we go back to our companies and say, by the way, we got to manage the risk and we made commitments and promises to be 100% renewable by such and such a date. So it's on us to figure out how are we going to do that? How are we going to figure that out and create the value, both economically and sustainability-wise, for the organizations that we serve? Second one is electrification. We're hearing this everywhere of companies that are burning fossil fuels that want to convert to electrification. And this is a big one as well. And it's entering just about every conversation with every client of how do we do this more effectively. The value chain side of it, right now the level of conversation as people look at their own scope one and scope two and say, that's okay, we're really happy we got our arms around that, but that's a small fraction of the total equation. How do we get in and engage with the whole ecosystem to address the full footprint? And I'll say, at Schneider, we are wrestling with that too. It's not easy, so we're wrestling with it as a company. How do we both go upstream and downstream and get our arms around all of this? And it's not as simple as just telling our suppliers, go do this and do it now. In parallel with this event, Schneider is running its global supply chain event. I think that starts maybe tomorrow, where our suppliers are coming in. We know, and I think one of the sessions we'll talk about what we see on the SEC rules here in the US, but we've seen the rulemaking in Europe, all of these different guidelines coming out. So there's reasons to address this. And I think of those reasons among four. There's pure economic, long-term interest in us all getting on this train and moving it forward, okay? There's also compliance issues that we all have to deal with on a regulatory front. Okay, so that's another good reason. There's also, how do we help and protect the planet? And by the way, I mean, I'm passionate as well about it, but it's got to be a combination of all of these things that's going to make, you know, the big difference. And so, and then fourth, we have pressures coming from our own ecosystem to do this. Okay, not just the regulatory compliance, but our customers, our clients, or our suppliers, both directions. So this whole value chain challenge is a big one. So that fourth one is a big one. And the fifth one category, I'd say, is the innovation side of it, because if we just stop and say, well, stop everything, let's go be, this is going to require a whole different level of ingenuity and innovation and creativity to get us there. We can't just sit back and do this. So we've got to keep moving the ball forward. We've got to keep meeting all of our own profitability targets and measures. And we've got these commitments and promises we've made about being 100% renewable or reducing my carbon footprint by such and such in 2025, more in 2030, complete net zero by 2040 or 2050. All of those things coming together in these four ways is going to be pretty interesting to see how we address that. And so I go back and I picture John Glenn looking at Katherine Johnson saying, I'll do this. You run the numbers. You tell me how to get there, and I'm ready to go. And that's the situation I think we're all going to find ourselves in. I think Schneider finds ourselves in that way too. And we have to constantly be looking at the climate. We're familiar with the Inflation Reduction Act, all of those things. And so we, as companies and individuals, we got to figure out how do we best utilize the tools and the techniques and the leverage that we have in front of us and create new things in order to accomplish these what feel like crazy objectives at a time that feels super crazy. I mean, I don't remember a time in my life where we have wars that seem to keep escalating as opposed to pull back, threats being made, and then the picture of seeing the impact of climate change. I watched a time lapse of what happened at Fort Myers in the storm surge, and oh my goodness. Now again, I can't point and say that's a direct result of climate change, but you can see the impact a near-term change in climate has on a particular environment. And it's almost like watching a fast forward of what could happen over the next 20, 30, 50 years on a time-lapse camera. You follow me on that? So I think these things are real. Actually, I know these things are real. And so we need to figure out how do we balance meeting the requirements on the risk management side, meeting the requirements on the electrification, how do we electrify what we do? How do we address these ecosystems in such a way that brings people together instead of a supplier sitting there feeling like, okay, you're telling me to be 100% renewable, and you're telling me to cut my price, and you're telling me this, and you're telling me that. How do we do this in a collaborative way that really looks at the overall health of the ecosystem that's around us? And that includes our financial health as well. Because let's face it, most all of us in this room are also in it to help our companies make money. And we shouldn't be embarrassed or shy about that, because we need that level of sustainability as well in order to continue to invest in lots of different ways. So oftentimes we talk about this being an evolution. By the way, I hate that word because it makes it sound like it's going to take centuries. We can't think about evolution anymore. We have to think about very fast transformations. What are we going to do different this week? What are we going to do different tomorrow? And take that step and figure out what it is. So dump that word from your vocabulary. It's a transformation. And it's a transformation that will require leadership. It's not just leadership. It's also partnership and working together. As the video shows, they didn't make it there one at a time. They made it there together. And we need that courage and that leadership to make that that transformation. So along with the transformation of courage and leadership, there's also a transformation that comes with integrity too. And I think we need to think and be real about how we address these things together and approach it in a way that addresses the health of the overall ecosystem. So we also find ourselves in this place at Schneider. And we often talk about this. So I'm not up here to lecture everybody, because we're on this journey too. And so oftentimes we'll use this slide just to, as a conversation piece, because on the left-hand side, we want to lead by example in our ecosystem. So we have all kinds of initiatives in Schneider to address how we go after the environment, social, and governance, and all of these pieces. In fact, every team member of Schneider has built into our compensation systems how we are doing as an overall company against these goals and targets. And I can tell you, it is not easy. It's hard, because there are some that we're knocking it down, and others, we're scratching our head trying to figure out, okay, we made these promises, how are we going to do this? How are we going to do it? These are tough. And so we're leading and learning in our own ecosystem. And that learning, by the way, requires a heavy dose of humility. Because the moment I stand here and say to you, I've got it all figured out, I'm telling you, there's something else I don't know. Actually, there's a lot I already don't know. Because a lot of the smart people are sitting in this room that will be on the speaker panel or in the audience asking great questions. But in order to exist, for us to be successful on the left side of this, we have to be willing to learn. And that takes humility in all of us, me as well, to be able to address and look at this and say, I don't know it all. Matt and Scott at AEG, you guys probably know a ton of stuff that I don't know. Scott, you and I were talking years ago about the straws in the different venues and how to do that. I mean, I was like, man, I didn't have a clue that was even going on. So there's stuff going on in all our different ecosystems that we can learn from each other. It requires humility on all our parts. And on the right-hand side, our business sits because we want to be the digital partner for sustainability and efficiency for our clients as well. So we want to take the things that we've learned as we are today over the last 20 years of being in this space and say, how do we serve better? How do we come alongside you? We want to be that digital partner for sustainability and efficiency and help you get better. Figure out what to do with that data. How do we leverage that data on your behalf to make you better? And then provide the services on top of it that come alongside and make you better. So we exist in both of these ecosystems, and yet both these ecosystems are really one. Because as we learn on our journey, we want to learn from your journey and feed into your journey as well. And so this is a piece, and you know, most of you have probably seen this slide. We think of it, and as we go out and survey different companies and see what makes them successful, our sense is the best-in-class approach it this way. They're dealing with strategy, they're digitizing their operations, and they're figuring out how do they decarbonize. Okay, and it's a loop. It's a circle for a reason, because it never stops. There's something else that's going to come up. Schneider, we're wrestling with how do we make sure that every product that we put on the market is more sustainable, is going to create a reduced footprint for our customers, whether it be switchgear, panels, our technologies, our software technologies, whatever it happens to be, how do we help them in this loop, both strategize, digitize, and decarbonize? And so while we use those terms in our own research as we look at different clients that are best in class, in some way, shape, or form, they're finding themselves in this rhythm, not a rut, but a rhythm of life where we're constantly addressing the strategy side. How do we digitize further parts of our operation, and how do we decarbonize? Okay, and then you have these crazy events that shake us up, whether it's a pandemic, or it's a war, or it's inflation, or it's a constrained supply chain that shake us up and say, we got to get back and look at this strategy. Is this the right strategy? Is it the right place and time? Should we do this or should we do that? How do we fulfill the promises that we've made before we get in that capsule and rely on the numbers that Katherine Johnson ran for John Glenn and for the NASA space program before they lifted off on a successful mission? How do we cross the boundaries that might have seemed at the time sacred boundaries that aren't crossed, that were stupid boundaries that shouldn't have been in place? So there's all of these kinds of things that are at play as we think about how we do this. So lastly, and I'll conclude here, we do want to leverage this event to accelerate your transformation, not your evolution, your transformation. And so I would just encourage you to explore these calculated risks. It's the what if. What if we did this? What would happen if we made this promise? What would happen if we made that promise? Or, holy cow, our CEO made this promise and we have no clue how we're going to go do this. Because by the way, if you dial back 5 or 10 years ago, most every target was out there was because the CEO got impatient and decided to throw the dart at the wall and say, we got to go to the moon. It's 1962, but we're going to get there by 1969. A lot of them do that. And now we're in the spot, together, we, of having to figure out, were those the right targets? How are we going to get there? What promises do we need to make to fulfill that? Ask probing questions. When you're in these sessions, have a ton of fun with it. Ask the hard questions. Just don't ask me those hard questions. There's a lot of others that I'd rather you ask those hard questions. But mix it up. Enjoy the time with fellow team members and figure out, you know, what are things that we should adopt and take away? And challenge your own thinking. Don't be comfortable. It's super easy for me to go into my business reviews in a defensive posture that I've got to go explain everything. I have to have an answer to everything. Okay, am I really challenging my own thinking? And am I saying yes when I mean yes, or no, I don't know when I don't know, and going around this room or asking other experts that are in the space, hey, how do I do this? And how could I do this differently? So I'd encourage you to do these three things. Explore, ask, and challenge yourselves throughout this week. Create the capital and the space for yourself to come away with something good this week. That's my wish. So I thank you for taking this time. I hope to have the chance to meet and chat with you, whether it's over different meals or in the hallways or in the sessions, and I really encourage you to have a great time here the next few days with our company. Thanks for being here.